I'm going to invite the panelists up on stage, and I'm going to begin with Mr. Mark Correll Billard, Global Senior Managing Director, Accenture Lab, who will also be our moderator. Mr. Koh Kong Ming, General Manager and Managing Director, South Asia and Korea, HP Inc. Vishal Ling, President Asia Pacific, GE Oil and Gas. And I have to extend an apology for Mr. Ng Wai Chung, Chief Executive of the Energy Market Authority. He's on medical leave, but I would ask for you all to really thank Dr. Elvin Yeo, who cleared his diary at very last minute to make it to today's event. A very warm and grateful welcome to Mr. Elvin Yeo, Director, Industry Development, Department, Energy Market Authority. And finally, last but not least, I'm going to welcome Mr. Mark Gainsborough, Executive Vice President, New Energies, Royal Dutch Shell. Welcome. Over to you, Mark.
Cecilia, thank you very much. I'm very pleased to be here with these very distinguished leaders. And I want to introduce a little bit the panel and what we're going to be discussing today together. So energy is essential to global economy. We know that. I mean, from fuel to fertilizers and manufacturing to transportation, energy enables the lifestyle that many enjoy today. Access to low-cost and reliable energy can transform quality of life and underpin economic growth. Asia is home to many fast-growing economies and a population that are rapidly urbanizing into the mega cities of the future. There are exciting times we're living here with growth and opportunities. Demand for more energy is expecting to grow by 2040 and to double to make this happen. And at the same time, the need to address environmental stresses has been very big, from air pollution to climate change. It's never been bigger than that before, okay? So that's what we call the dilemma. So that call for dramatic shift in the type of energy consumed over the decades ahead. Energy transition will unfold at different places, in different paces across Asia, and across all facets of economic activities, from power generation to energy use in buildings, transport industries, and more. How will these changes impact how we live, we work, we play? How can our cities become models for sustainable growth? How can we catalyze cross-border collaboration to tackle the region's future energy challenges, and how can solution-oriented policies and technology will help? So again, today I'm delighted to be joined by these very talented people, and they're gonna help me to answer these big themes that we talk about, this ASEAN cleaner energy dilemma. And I'd like to start with the first question, which is more an introductory question that will give the panelists the opportunity to tell us about what they think their organization is planning to do related to addressing this energy dilemma. And I'd like to start this first question, in fact, with Mark, because Mark's from Shell, and I think this is an event hosted by Shell. So it makes sense that we start with you, Mark.
Indeed, although, you know, a big part of what we want to do today as Shell is listen to the views of other people.
So okay.
You put me on the spot a bit by asking me to go first, but you know, I think, you know, going back to, you know, the whole reason we're here is this challenge around, you know, a sustainable future for the planet. And the dilemma we've got is the world needs significantly more energy. And, you know, sitting here in Singapore, it's easy to take for granted the energy and the access to energy that we have. But there are billions of people on the planet that don't yet have access to energy, that don't enjoy all the benefits of economic development that go with energy. So we've got to there's a lot of people on the planet we've got to help to go up that energy ladder. But the challenge is going to be to do that in a sustainable way. As you heard from John Abbott at the beginning, in this part of the world, in the developing, in Asia Pacific, tremendous growth in energy demand in the coming decades. Yet we've got the challenge at the same time to deliver that, we have to reduce emissions. Both local air quality is a challenge in many cities around the world, and also CO2, we know we have to get by the middle of this century to a net zero carbon emissions. That is one of the biggest challenges the human race has ever faced. And we all need to be working hard on delivering that solution. Now, I think, as you all have detected from John's remarks at the beginning, and I'm going to reinforce it, Shell, we absolutely believe we have to get this balance right between providing more energy, which is what we've been doing for the last 100 plus years of our existence. We've been meeting that demand for more energy. We have to do it in a more sustainable and cleaner way. And of course, you know, it's an exciting opportunity for me personally. I've been asked to lead Shell's new energies business. So I'm right in the forefront of what Shell is trying to do here about finding more sustainable forms of energy to complement our existing business. And you know, you heard John talking about the whole natural complementarity between our gas business and the renewables business. And you know, maybe we'll talk a bit more about that in the future. So but the challenge is more energy, cleaner energy, and you know, where are we going to find the right balance between growth and sustainability going forwards?
That's very clear, Mark. Thanks very much. I mean, I think we'll come back to this this balance. I want to pass on the baton to Alvin and hear a perspective from basically the energy markets that you're representing here.
Thank you. And I was listening quite intensely to what John was sharing earlier about the growth of energy and in Asia. In fact, in Southeast Asia, we do see that the growth will in fact increase by nearly 80% over the next 5 years. And by with that, actually, you will see carbon emission raising by maybe about 2.3%. Then by itself, when we were thinking about this challenge, I would like to think it more as an opportunity for us to do some work around three areas. I think the first area that we see is with a lot more renewables coming on board, especially the intermittent nature of solar, wind, which actually does impact grid stability as well as the system security, there is an opportunity for us to push a lot more research innovation in new areas such as storage, energy storage systems, solar forecastings that act as balancing systems to our entire power grid. I think the other second area that we have been thinking about, and I think it's a point that I think John talked about earlier, different countries are in different stages in development, and I think for Singapore, we're always wondering how best to balance the trilemma for us between having energy security, environmental sustainability, and yet at the same time, having affordable pricing. Associated with this is actually, there's a lot of instructive lessons that we are drawing from different countries in Japan, in China, in South Korea, even in Germany and Denmark, where there is a bit of a change in government policies moving away from subsidies like feed-in tariffs and to one which is a little bit more competitive in nature. I think that's something that Singapore has been a position that we have taken in from day one, mainly that we will price it right from the first electron, and then we'll let the markets work out the equilibrium. And I think this is something that we continually look at it and see how we can better balance. And I think the third dilemma and challenge that we actually have been pondering about is, as we transform to this cleaner energy world, what kind of skill sets would you need for our workforce, for people to be ready? For example, how do you get more workers trained in terms of solar PV integration with our current grid? And yet, they can connect it safely while still keeping the lights on. So I think in brief, these are the three areas that we have been thinking quite a bit in terms of where Singapore can better exploit the opportunities for that cleaner future.
Thank you, Alvin. I appreciate that. I mean, I think you get a good point. I mean, it's like, how are we going to incentivize also, I mean, workers, I mean, to play and use technology, I mean, to go into this new energy, but that's well, I mean, it's like educating people also, and we'll come back to that, on how they're going to leverage this new energy, how are we going to incentivize them, I mean, to buy this product that we can reduce basically the carbon footprint. Now, I'd like to hand over to Wiesel. I mean, Wiesel, as part of General Electric, I mean, I know that you guys are pushing like big time on many type of different sectors. I mean, it's like this clean energy and everything. So give us our perspective, your perspective.
Yes, good morning. First of all, thank you very much to Shell for the opportunity to be here. And congratulations on an event which looks really fantastic. This is my first time participating, but it looks amazing. So yes, from a General Electric GE perspective, I think a lot of things have been said. The angle where we are coming from is really focusing on technology. Yeah. You know, so what we do, we have a manufacturing background heritage. So when you think from extraction to all the way to platform, to powering, to power plants, you need to have technology that is really efficient, in terms of burning, you know, fuel on a gas turbine, or even solar panels. You know, they need to be efficient. So this is really our, I would say, our focus on technology. And I think Alvin said it as well. The key things for a cleaner energy is the cost. So we are working very hard on lowering the cost, because today the reality is that, in general, cleaner energy is more expensive than traditional energy, if you call it, you know, coal. So a lot of progress has been made, but we have to work on both fronts, continue to invest in technology, get the cost down, and of course, work as a partnership with the governments, with the consumers, and with the rest of the ecosystem, what I would call the producers.
Thanks, Vidal. All right, Komeng, as we have to discuss about what is the perspective of HP in all these discussions. I'd like to hear about that.
Well, so Mark, when I got the invitation to attend this conference, I thought it was an oil and gas industry conference. And I thought, okay, I'm from technology, right? So I'll be able to talk a lot about technology, and none of you in the audience will be able to understand what I'm talking about. And then when Cecilia asked who's from technology, I see half the room's hands goes up. So unfortunately, I can't talk about technology either, because I don't know anything about that. Probably you guys know more than me. But I'm here to talk about what HP as a consumer, as a manufacturer, and as an end user of energy, and what we do internally as well, and what we do with our customers to be able to help them to achieve their goals in terms of sustainable and renewable energy.
Very good. So now we're going to move forward. And obviously, I mean, to drive these new energy models, I mean, it's like, obviously, we talk about technology. And I mean, a little bit like on Meng, I mean, just like, I've been working at Shell as my client, and when I as part of Accenture, and I lead all our labs where we do research and development. So technology is my life, and I love to talk about innovation, you know. And obviously, I mean, technology innovation is going to have like a big place in the play of moving to new energy. So what I would like to discuss with the panelists is that very concrete examples, because this is where we are right now. I think what we need is to come up with very concrete example to explain this. Yes, basically we're addressing this. This is what we're doing, and this is how we can deploy at scale. So I'd like to discuss first with Mark, and you know that I work for your company where we've been driving a lot of innovation programs. That was pretty exciting stuff. So I'd like you to tell me more into the new business that you're driving, how you see innovation and technology to drive very concrete example of helping to work out this dilemma.
Yeah, I mean, clearly, you know, technology is going to be absolutely key to solving the challenges that we have around more and cleaner energy. But I think the history of the solar industry, is the solar PV industry, is a great example of technology improvement making making it a more competitive source of energy. So, we mentioned already the sort of challenges to get the cost down of right. New technologies. Oil and gas were unbelievably cost effective as a source of energy. And for a long time, the other alternatives, renewables, couldn't really compete with that. But what we've seen in the past few years is tremendous acceleration in the rate of the efficiency, for example, of solar panels. So the efficiency has gone up tremendously, and the cost of manufacturing and installing them has gone down dramatically. To the point now where a utility-scale solar PV plant can produce power at lower cost than a coal-fired power plant if you were building one from scratch. So I think that's a great example of where and that's real technology innovation that has driven us down the cost curve. And I think it's back to Alvin's point as well, is it's great to have a source of energy that's secure, it's great to have one that is sustainable, but it's got to be affordable as well in the end. And if you went back 30 years, the only place where solar PV was affordable was on satellites, as a source of power for a satellite circling the Earth. You know, now we're at the point where it's a fully competitive source of power for consumers, and also you've got the opportunity to have a much more distributed energy system as well, which has a whole ton of other potential economic benefits. So I think that's an example of where progress has been made. But of course, as an industry, we're not satisfied with where that is at the moment. And here in Singapore, we have the Solar Energy Research Institute of Singapore, SERIS, is a great example of work being done to further improve the efficiency of solar PV and to drive it further down the cost curve. So I think the solar industry is a really great example of where we've seen innovation. And of course, a lot of the innovation has actually been on the back of the semiconductor industry, one of the biggest revolutionary industries. And of course, HP, you've been intimately involved with that that revolution. And so solar PV has been riding a bit on the back of the innovation in the semiconductor business. But it's true in many other areas as well. You know, the other area that we're deeply interested in is around wind power. You know, in Shell, we have existing wind assets we've been running for over a decade. We're building some new offshore wind in Europe at the moment. Again, the cost curve, you know, the cost reductions there have been dramatic, driven by rolling out the technology on a much bigger scale. Mm-hmm. So it's not only about innovation, it's about deploying a technology at scale helps you get down the learning curve.
Yep.
We're seeing that happening with battery storage as well. So electric vehicles, again, will come down the cost curve. Also, as we roll them out, so will hydrogen-powered vehicles as well. So, you know, innovation is really driving us down the cost curve very fast. And that's what I see the biggest benefit of technology is making these options that provide us with cleaner energy more affordable.
I like very much what you said, because we talk about energy, but I think like the economics of technology is changing the world. I mean, when you see the cost of storage, you see the cost of high-performance computing, you see the capability to gather data and be able basically to do analytics so that basically we understand basically how people are using energy so we can advise them on better options and how to do that. I think that's absolutely spot on. That's going to be fundamental. I would like to do maybe a parallel that you're going to think it's maybe a bit stretched, is that I see solar, and in France, I mean, because je suis français, I saw that there was a lot of winters in solar. Okay, it went up and down, and government got basically regulated that business, and it was not so interested for customers anymore, you know, and it was costly and everything. And I see it's back again, and you're right. So I would see a parallel with artificial intelligence, where there was a lot of winters on artificial intelligence, and et voila, now, and because it's starting to be more affordable and people get excited about it, you know, they start to do a lot of good work with this. And you see, artificial intelligence is hard, we talk about it and everything. So solar is a good example of this. So well, that's a good segue for me, I mean, to discuss with Alvin. So looking at solar panel, looking at wind energy and everything, I mean, what do you think about how basically government is really driving, also helping innovation? And I know that basically you manage a portfolio of innovation activities, so you can tell us more about it.
I must say that I've been very privileged to be in this cycle of the changing power systems, because I'm seeing evolutions in three areas broadly. Yep. One is on the supply side, one is on the grid side, another on the demand side. When we actually fund R&D in Singapore, I think we look at what value it brings in terms of meeting our national needs, some of which are very unique, and in terms of how do you meet the economic needs of Singapore. As you know, we have been positioning ourselves in Singapore as a living lab. There's a lot of new ideas, control experiments, and I'll share with you some examples of projects that we have funded, which we thought is quite interesting. On the supply side, for example, our plants on a yearly basis, we sometimes get a bit of haze, and when the haze hits us in Singapore, our plant performance actually dips by up to 30%. And then the question is, when you, for a lot of our plants, you actually need to keep filters, and each filter can be up to $1 million. Then the question is, how do you work with universities? And that's the point about Vissel talking about collaboration. That's where you work with them and see there are new ideas around using wet and dry coagulation processes, which actually reduce and eliminate the use of filters. So that's an example of how we fund R&D, which meets Singapore's uniquely special needs here.
And just one question on this, Alvin. Do you see that also material science, like graphene, nanotechnology and everything can help, basically?
It is. It's quite interesting because building on to, I think, Mark's point about solar PV, we have seen evolution going from solar silicon, moving on to thin film, perovskites, and now we're even looking at the next generation of PV materials, where you're looking at the kind which is organic-based and is able to take surfaces which is a bit more curved. That actually opens up a lot of opportunities for more creative deployments of solar, because we have a lot of pathways here, some of which are curved in nature and some building facades. So I think that's where we work by Solar Energy Research Institutes, and many of the companies here actually have contributed to this whole evolution of solar PV industry here. But what we're also witnessing, actually, interestingly, is beyond just the R&D, it's a lot of new business models that's coming on. You have companies which are pioneering the solar leasing models here, for example, where Sunsip, and you have companies like Cleantech Solar, which have actually have taken some of these ideas after being test-bedded here, and in fact supported companies like Apple to power their entire operations here in Singapore 100%, or even for Coca-Cola in Cambodia. So it's about meeting the national needs as well as having an economic, capitalizing on the economic opportunities in this area. So I think on the grid side, we actually see a lot of opportunities because we are one of the very unique places in Singapore where the entire network is underground. That by nature actually introduces an opportunity for us to do condition monitoring, analytics, so that you can detect corrosion on the pipes. And I think this is an area that is very uniquely Singapore again. And on the demand side, we have a lot of new ideas around demand response, and a lot of this is more business model than just technology, where you actually ask consumers of large energy to switch off their operations when the energy prices are high in return for a financial incentive. So we're witnessing a lot of changes from catalyzed through R&D in the areas of supply, grid, and demand.
It's very dynamic. I mean, I love the examples. I mean, that's great. So Vizal, I mean, give me some example of what GE is doing. I mean, you have this fantastic platform, Predix, and it's give us like.
Well, the technology I would categorize in two buckets, and I'll give you some example. I think there is what I would call the traditional technology. You mentioned, you know, materials. So, for example, at GE, we have aircraft engines, and we take material that you use in an aircraft engine to put in a gas turbine, so it becomes more efficient. You can run it at higher temperature. We have a healthcare business where you do. You do scan of your heart or of your bones. So we take that technology and we put it into sensors so that we can see what's happening into those assets. So the transfer of technology between different segments is happening. That's what I would call the, and we can have better material, better efficiency, and we will work on, and we are working on this. I think the whole industry is working on it. And then there is the second thing, which I think is also interesting, what you alluded to, which is around big data, analytics, digital. I was just looking at the container outside. You can have a flavor of what's going on. But the whole idea, and I'm so happy, you know, that Alvin talked about condition monitoring on pipes underground. The whole idea here from that technology standpoint is to connect assets. And what I call assets is a gas turbine, a compressor, a pump, a valve. We have thousands, millions of assets out there. But today, they are not very intelligent.
Yeah.
If you are sitting in country outside Singapore, you have power trips. You don't have electricity all the time or water all the time. And it's because it's inefficient. The assets don't run all the time. They don't tell you when they're going to break down. So the whole idea of digital is to put some sensors on this machine, understand when they're going to break down, do some predictive maintenance, put all of this on a platform. I can talk about ours. I know it's not the case about the platform that we have developed, but to connect all of the assets around the world and across customers.
One thing that you just mentioned that I love specifically, and I really believe in this, is that what I call the combinatorial effect of technology. Where it's starting to be really interesting is that when you see the technology to play together, because if you add them all together, the sum is bigger than taking them one by one. So we're talking about machine learning. You're talking about analytics. You're talking about sensing technology, IoTs and everything. You put that whole stuff together, you're going to be able to do something really amazing. So that's exactly what you just described. But we talk about this, for example, for managing system, managing products, have more smarter product. But what we see also is that we can do also energy more efficient, or we can do energy safety in the way you design product, for example. And I just wanted to give you an example. And as a moderator, maybe I can give you a couple of examples too. The fact that new companies like Autodesk are working on generative design. Generative design will help you basically to put sensors on products you're going to create so that you gather information about it. And using machine learning, you're going to redesign them almost real time. So they're going to be lighter, more solid, meaning that when you're going to put them basically in our aircraft, then it's going to be, because it's lighter, then you have less fuel consumption. That's how it's going to work. So I think we're going to see also in terms of the manufacturing how it's going to play. And I think that's a great segue again, yes, for 3D printing and our friend from HP. So tell us about it.
So Mark, I mean, a lot of talk and discussion about cleaner energy production, cheaper energy production. But I just want to remind us that, you know, at the end of the day, it's about consumption mm-hmm. as well, right? How much energy we consume on a daily basis. And if you look at the technology or the way technology has developed over the last 20, 30 years, we've always followed this thing called Moore's Law, that performance doubles every 12 to 18 months, yep. and the price drops by about the same amount.
Yeah.
Right. And that's also why the solar PV is also going the same way. But for us as a company, we look at sustainability in a number of different ways. We are, first of all, a consumer of energy, and we want to be fully sustainable, fully renewable in the future as well. Right. The SunSeep example in Singapore is great. And we're looking at how we can do that locally also. The other part of it is, you know, we manufacture a lot of products, as you know, and some of them may not be as environmentally friendly as what people may assume. And we look very seriously at the materials we use, the provenance of these materials, where they come from, are they from conflict zones or not, all the way down to how we actually use our energy, and also the energy consumption that goes into our products. So we look for ways to make them as efficient, as energy efficient as possible. And with the help of our partners like Intel, et cetera, we're able to do that. That's on, I guess, the current model. Mm-hmm. Now, if you look into the future, this thing called 3D printing, Mark, and that has the potential to really change the way manufacturing and logistics is done. And manufacturing and logistics are two of the areas where energy consumption is huge, right? So if we have really good 3D printers and not just print plastics, for example, which is freely available today, but also metals, you can really sort of turn the whole manufacturing supply chain upside down. So today, instead of manufacturing in locations in China, in huge factories, and then shipping out all the products all over the world, imagine a world where there are no warehouses, there are no large manufacturing sites anywhere in the world, but basically 3D printing shops in Singapore could be down the street from your house, could be in a larger location somewhere else, maybe in a shopping mall, that anytime you wanted a product or a spare part, go online, order it, and in a couple of hours, or in a few hours, a few days, it could be printed and delivered right to your doorstep, or you could go down and pick it up yourself. Those would be tremendous savings in terms of both energy as well as consumption of resources, be it in transportation, be it in storage of materials, you know, and it could really potentially change the way we live and work and play, and as a result have a huge consequence on our energy consumption.
That's a great answer. And like, I just want to see with you. I mean, it's like, where is this future? Is it something like coming like in the next 2, 3 years, 5 years?
Oh, or you? Yeah, Mark. Unfortunately, it's not going to happen in the next 5 or 10 years. It could start to happen in about 20 years time when that kind of vision that we have is implemented, and it could be implemented in many, many different ways. Today, I think UPS is already starting a 3D printing facility or service in Singapore, and we could take that even further in the next 5 to 10 years.
Okay, and I guess, I mean, that will be obviously some impact on the way you regulate the trades of the parts that you need to ship back and forth and everything, because then you're going to produce basically the parts really at the location where you're going to need it for the manufacturer and everything. So
exactly.
So, all right. So
just
let's go ahead.
An example.
You
like examples.
I love it.
When we talk about 3D printing.
Yeah.
It's already here, maybe not in the printing shop, you know, besides your house, but if I give an example of aircraft engine, mm-hmm. GE today print fuel nozzles. So this is the part that, you know, mix the air and the fuel and put it in your aircraft engine, which fly you up. So it's really high performance, mm-hmm. very under a lot of stress, and today it is already 3D printed.
So that's a great news, because it's not like 3D printing just part for models, but it's really something that is a production part that you're going to be able to leverage.
Yes.
A company like Carbon 3D, using clips and stuff like that, I mean, leverage these kind of technology.
We've also been thinking about how we could use 3D printing in our offshore installations in oil and gas. You know, so rather than keeping huge inventories of spare parts, you actually just print them to as you need them.
When you need
again,
them.
Again,
right.
It makes tremendous savings. I think the whole thing about 3D printing is, in a way, an example of decentralization versus centralization. In the sort of one of the big transitions in the energy system, we'll see more and more decentralized power, distributed power, and that'll have to work somehow in tandem with the traditional grid-based systems. I'm sure this is one of the things Alvin is and EMA are thinking a lot about. How do you get that integration to work seamlessly? And although things like solar PV and wind have come down in cost a lot, but they are intermittent, and we have to find a way to sort of combine intermittent power with what's available through the grid. So I think the whole way you connect the two together and how you use digital as your way of doing that is going to be a huge opportunity space to improve efficiency both for individual enterprises and for the system as a whole. I know, talking to some of the big power utilities in Europe, you know, they said that if we really got our act together in doing that, we could reduce total demand by about 30-40% of electricity in the coming decades, which would be a huge contribution to meeting some of the objectives set out in the Paris Agreement.
Great. So let's pause on technology because, I mean, we can keep talking about technology innovation. I mean, it's like for the whole panel. I want to shift gears a little bit. And I want to start talking about, I mean, this is not only technology that is important here. Okay. Accenture Labs, for example, every year we issue a technology vision and we think about technology trends that will impact the organization of our clients. This year, one of our trends is called the Uncharted. And the Uncharted is the following. If you come up with new product, new services and everything, maybe regulation are not equipped basically to help you out to deploy them at large. Maybe you need to do standards. Maybe you need to work with government agencies and everything to change basically what's happening today because the technology goes so fast that you need to adapt to it, okay? So it's a great question for Alvil. I mean, I'd like to discuss with you because I know that technology goes so fast and then we see government agencies looking around and says like, okay, I'm gonna catch up with all these things. How are we gonna create new models and everything? So tell me, what are you doing specifically, I mean, to deploy and to adopt all those new energies and changing the rule, okay, the rule of the game. Mm.
For us, when we think about how to work with companies and businesses, I think we loosely think it around the four R's. I think the first R that we always think about is how do you do the right pricing? And a lot of it has to do with what I mentioned earlier, where we chose not to go with voluntary subsidies to allow the market to find its natural equilibrium.
Right.
And interestingly, such an approach actually works because we have seen the growth of solar PV here from growing by nearly about 30-fold to today about 126 megawatts peak here in Singapore, and that without any subsidies. So I think from a policy perspective, that's something we think is a little bit more sustainable over the longer term. And it's about also pricing in the cost of the intermittency into how we charge consumers eventually. Because every time there is intermittency, you have to call on your reserves to supplement. And I think the point that I think Mark made earlier. The second area that we have been working quite hard to actually help businesses is actually in the whole area of regulation reduction and innovation, which is a point that you brought up. In the area of regulation reduction, one of the things that we have done is actually to simplify the length of time you need from 27 days to today about 7 days for you to connect to solar PV. We also made it easier for small producers of solar PV to receive payment through a market clearing system. We put up more information so that large businesses can make informed decisions on which solar PV manufacturers or which business models to go for.
So how do you do that? I mean, is it cutting down in the process? Is it like driving more technology? Or is like, what is that? What's the miracle?
I think, it's no miracle, but I think it's a lot of hard work between the government working together with industries like Singapore Power. We work together to see how do you cut down the red tape and the requirements without compromising on electrical safety. So it's about review of processes more than anything else.
Okay.
And to extend the idea a little bit further beyond just regulation reduction, there is a whole area of regulation innovation too. Because when you have innovation, often like you mentioned earlier, the policies don't catch up quite quickly.
Yeah.
Yeah, so an area that I think Mark alluded to is actually in energy storage systems. We're studying it very closely right now. Last year, we made an announcement about how we worked with Singapore Power to actually do a pilot to try different energy storage systems for different power applications. At the same time, we actually launched a policy consultation paper. And as to how do you treat batteries? Do you treat them as load or do you treat them as supply generation? Because that has implications in a sector like ours, which is not vertically integrated, but separated across your generation, transmission, distribution, and demand. The third area that I thought I should talk a little bit more is also about how do you raise demand through public sector taking a lead. And one of the areas that I think has worked quite well, thanks to colleagues from the Economic Development Board, Housing Development Board, as well as the Public Utilities Board, is a program called Solar Nova, where we attempted to push a target of 350 megawatts peak by 2020. It has gotten a lot of traction in that process, and companies like SunSip have benefited from that by being able to use the rooftops of the typical public housing that we have here in Singapore. And then 20-30% of what they produce actually is used to power the common services, the rest is exported to the grid. And it's through national initiatives like this where the government comes together as one that presents a lot of more business opportunities for the smaller companies. And I think the last one we have talked quite a bit in terms of the last hour is actually the whole area of research and innovation. And I can go on about what kind of battery storage systems you're thinking about from your lithium ion, redox flow, flywheels. And these are very interesting and there isn't a lot of clear answers right now for us, but we are pushing the boundaries on this. We're also looking at some of the areas on distributed generation, microgrids, whether blockchain technologies could be used, for example, for microgrids that are interconnected with one another. And we, in fact, have a very nice control experiment today in Pulau Ubin, where we brought together 30 end users on a voluntary basis, and they actually draw on clean energy powered by solar PV and a combination of biodiesel. And what they have is actually a microcosm of different smart grid technologies, your condition monitoring systems, your smart meters, down to your solar PV, and the ideas that we are implementing there, including the sensors, we hope to be able to transplant that to the mainland in a future where the power system evolves from a centralized nature to one which is more distributed in.
Well, that's a great answer. I mean, it's just like a lot of examples. And thank you very much for that. Now, we heard your perspective, which I think is interesting. I mean, I'd like to hear the perspective of Mark Vizela and Komeng, related more to the private party. So how you guys are working with the NGOs and everything, the governments? And
I mean, I'd have to say, if only life was as easy elsewhere as it is in Singapore, in the sense
that
Singapore has a much more rational policy framework than most other countries, where frankly energy policy is often very confused and often conflicting. And I think, you know, one of the biggest challenges we have in our dialogue with governments is about, you know, trying to convince people that it's not a good idea to continue building coal-fired power generation. We don't really see how we'll meet any of our objectives around sustainability if we continue to use coal and grow the use of coal. Now, I think that's starting to shift now. We see countries like China slowing down on coal-fired power and making a renewed commitment to more gas in the mix, to bringing renewables faster. But it is a challenge. And, you know, of course, from a Shell perspective, you know, typically we like markets to operate efficiently and free markets. Frankly speaking, you know, sometimes the implementation of new technologies does require a bit of government help to get going. One of the reasons that solar PV got down the cost curve was that cumulatively had $100 billion of subsidies from different governments around the world that helped it to get to scale. And I think there are a few other technologies which are going to be part of the solution that are going to need a lot of working between the private sector and government. You know, particularly if you think about hydrogen as a potential transport fuel, has a huge set of potential benefits. But to get the infrastructure in place, it does require a lot of working between the public sector and government. We're probably most advanced in developing hydrogen infrastructure in Germany, where, you know, we're part of a consortium with substantial support from the German government to make that happen.
Right.
Another technology that's going to be very important in the coming decades is carbon capture and storage. For most countries to meet their climate change objectives, they won't be able to do it without having oil and gas in the mix, and you need to think down the track of having carbon capture and storage deployed at scale. And that's an area where government support for those projects has wavered quite a bit. We've had quite a few projects that we were developing with government support, and the government support was taken away. So I think, you know, our challenge is normally to get a policy framework that's going to be consistent for a long period of time, so that as industry we can make real sensible decisions about where to invest and which technologies to be developing. So I think that our biggest ask would be to have, you know, a rational policy framework like Singapore, but also with some consistency over time, because if it changes from one administration to the next, we're all left wondering how to manage this energy transition.
All right. I'm conscious of the time here. I mean, like, I'm looking at the ticker here, and I'd like to have like a question related to connected customers. I think one thing what we said is, like, we talk about regulation, we talk about technology, we talk about how are we going to change the behavior of customers so that they select the right product to minimize the carbon footprint, or basically, and engaging them, I mean, to go through new energies and everything. We talk about technology, that we can learn about their behavior, we can do a lot of things with this, but I'd like to have the perspective from our friend from HP and GE on this one.
Well, I just have one basic question,
yeah,
and you know, that I think all of us can try and answer for each of ourselves. And then I'll ask Alvin as well, because he's from the public sector in the government. And the question is this, right? Would we, given that all things are being equal from a product perspective, would we be willing to choose one that is slightly more expensive, but a lot more environmentally friendly or friendlier, and how much would that be? Because ultimately it's about consumption. We talk a lot about the production aspect of it, but if we continue to use devices, technology that consumes a lot more power or a lot more energy, then you know, all the good work that our friends on this side of the house are doing is gonna go to waste. So ask ourselves, how much are we willing to be able to pay for the use of much more energy efficient devices? Because all these things come at a cost. And I'm telling you that from a manufacturer's point of view. You know, and on the other side of it, it's what is the public sector, for example, doing to drive that? In Singapore, personally, we've seen a lot of activity around basically light bulbs, right? But I think it has to go way beyond just more energy efficient light bulbs, LED lighting. What are we doing with all the devices? Each of us today carries 2, 3, sometimes 4 devices that unfortunately consume power and also, you know, have batteries in them that store power. So what can we as the private sector and the public sector do together in order for us to enable that?
I thought one of the things that is something that we actually learned quite a bit from the UK government actually is in terms of how do you shift consumer behavior through the nudge effect, they call it. So what we have done is in Singapore is we worked with Singapore Power to redesign the bills to give you a little bit more information about how do you stand versus your neighbors versus nationally for the type of household that you have.
So gamification type of thing, get them excited about this.
Get them excited, giving them a little bit of information, of create a little bit of a competitive spirit so that perhaps you will tend to save a lot more. The other whole area that we are thinking about is about how do you use home energy management systems, which tells you that your aircon is the largest consumer at home, you should shut it down, you should keep your switches on not on a standby mode, but to switch it off. I think there's a lot of public education that can be done, and a lot of this is being pushed today as part of the broader energy efficiency efforts that the government is working with different companies.
That's right.
Just to bounce back on this and what Kong Weng said, I think it has to be a lot of focus on what value do you bring to the customer or to the consumer. Mm. How simpler or easier you make my life. Before, you know, to book a taxi, okay, you call and maybe you stay on the line for a couple of minutes or a lot of time if it's raining in Singapore. Now you go through the apps and it's easier. Are you willing to pay a bit of a premium for that? And in general, I mean, we can see that it's yes. So I think there is a lot of focus from all companies to look at the value that we bring to the customers. And you know, if I put it back to the cleaner energy, the oil and gas sectors, we would work, for example, with company with Shell, and how can you make your maintenance turnaround, you know, faster, safer? How can your engineer on a platform can get a 3D printed part without having to wait for field engineers to be deployed on a chopper, etc.? So I think a lot of work has to be done around what is the value that we're unlocking with these new technologies. And I think a lot is coming from those digital...
I think with a lot of the connected customer concepts, the big win is that they tremendously improve the sort of economic efficiency of the system.
That's right.
You know, for a lot of the car sharing concepts now, people are realizing the average car is sitting idle for 96% of the time. So now you see even the big auto manufacturers are realizing that the sort of shared economy models are going to have a big impact on their business, and are recognizing that probably, you know, peak auto sales is in the next 10 years because there's going to be so much better utilization of vehicles in the future. So connected customer applications in the mobility space are going to radically impact on probably both the energy for mobility, but also the auto sector as well.
And I like very much, I mean, what we just said. I mean, I think building an experience, harvesting, finding basically the value of what it is. Our technology vision this year was technology by people for people. I would say it's like almost as a conclusion, it's energy by people, energy for people. I mean, when you're going to drive basically the value, the emotion, the experience, a partnership that you can build basically between government and between private sectors and your consumers and everything. I mean, this is basically unlocking the potential.
But I think one of the key points that was raised was, will consumers pay more for a more sustainable product, whether it's more sustainable energy or a more sustainable printer or a more sustainable computer? And our experience is, you know, there's a segment of the market that will pay a bit more, and they help you to sort of get your offering to scale. But in the end, you have to use scale economies to have something that is economically viable and it offers economic value. Otherwise, in the long run, it's very hard to sustain it. So I think that, you know, what we have to have in mind all the time is, you know, how are we going to create that value for customers in the short term? But in the end, we've got to get our new technologies and our new products to scale so that they can be competitive versus the alternatives. And then you get into a virtuous circle where you're in the money with your new technology and the consumers see it's better, and by the way, it costs me less than it did before.
Indeed. Cecilia, how are we doing in terms of times? One last question, maybe?
I think maybe we open it up to the floor.
All right, let's do that. Okay. Well, we want to make it very inclusive, so we're going to open the panel and to you guys and to ask you some questions that would be related to what we just discussed. So please be free. A great question. Is there a mic that we can turn around? All right, that'd be great. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the very interesting discussion. I was wondering, as you were speaking, how can we have this reality check on the base of the pyramid, democratizing these kind of concepts to the bigger scale countries that are sort of having a lower income? So how can what we've been discussing democratize these things?
Great question. Who's going to want to pick this up?
I think that's the great opportunity that we have with some of these new distributed energy systems. It's a real chance to give access to energy to the people that don't have any at the moment. So you're absolutely right. At the base of the pyramid, there are a ton of people that don't have all the fancy things that we're talking about, and have waited a long time for that. So what we're seeing is, you know, much more potential. Again, as we drive down the cost, it starts to become affordable, even for people at the base of the energy pyramid. So I think we'll see a lot more distributed energy systems going into rural communities. In Shell, we're looking at how we can move into a sort of commercial space there and make that sort of offering. We've been working on an energy access program through the Shell Foundation for about the past 10 years. Shell Foundation is a charitable foundation set up by Shell with Shell money, but they're independent from Shell, so they're not a business. But they've had some great learnings, and I've got a team now who are trying to take those learnings from basically philanthropic work and say, could we deploy this at bigger scale on a commercial basis? And again, it's the combination of costs coming down in the core technology plus digitalization that starts to open that up. So now you can have a low-cost microgrid with probably solar PV, maybe with a diesel genset as well. You can install it, and it comes in a container, you put it into a village, and by the way, people pay for the power through their mobile phones, because mobile phone penetration is already quite high in a lot of these rural communities. So thinking about how we take power off-grid to those sort of communities, I think is one example of how we can start to democratize and make things more accessible to a wider part of the population. But I'm sure there are probably some other examples.
Yeah, maybe two quick examples. If I take it from the angle, can you bring affordable energy to places where maybe people cannot, you know, afford it? So I think you have to think about not just bringing the technology, but how do you create jobs in a particular place, for example? How you train the people in terms of the skills, and of course how you bring the cost down. So, for example, now there are technology. You could have a power plant on shore. Now there is a lot of discussion on power plant on a barge or on a vessel that you can move from places to places. So you make a one-time investment, but after that you can move it. You know, there is a couple of countries here in this region which have stranded asset resources, whether it's gas, it's oil, and a one-time big investment doesn't work. But if you can move it, then that's one thing. Now I will switch to another example in healthcare. Okay, it's not oil and gas, but healthcare. Today, if you go to a hospital in Singapore, you can have an MRI, CT scan of your brain, etc. It's very expensive, maybe a couple of $100. We have to develop technologies which are less expensive. So, for example, a scanner. We have done it in India, in China, where the price point goes very low. But yeah, you have to educate the nurses, the doctors in the places. So there is a lot of adoptions also to be done across those technologies. So it's not just developing the technology. It has to be at the right price point with the education and the system that goes around it to deploy the technology as well.
I like what you said. I mean, I think the education is very important. I would like to say also that thanks to technology, some devices will be able to be used by people that didn't have the education to use them. So a very good example of that, if you look at a 3D scanner, from Leica Geo System and everything, a few years ago, it was very difficult for people to 3D scan part of a refinery and everything because they need to know exactly how to position the device. But adding machine learning, artificial intelligence made them smart. They will guide the worker to exactly position the scanner so that they know exactly how they're going to scan it right. So I think there's like two things that we're going to see. There's going to be a price point that we're going to see on the product they're going to do good on. But also the intelligence of the system will make them to be used by more and more people, which is exactly what we want.
Maybe I should just add on to what has been shared. One very good example that I can think about is, again, at the Pulau Ubin microgrid test bit, which has been completed. It's constructed since 2013. The microgrid operator by itself has brought the idea to a lot of off-grid communities in the region. And previously, when on the island, the typical resident or business there will actually be charged roughly about $1.20 per kilowatt hour because they use diesel generators, which sometimes are pollutive and they break down. The microgrid operator came in, offered reliable electricity through a combination of solar PV, storage, and also a little bit of diesel, biodiesel. And the price went down to 80 cents per kilowatt hour, significantly higher than on the mainland today. But the idea today, this company has actually gone to 68 countries worldwide, including the Maldives, the Sri Lanka, Vietnam, and even to South Africa to take this idea of microgrid internationally.
Right, it's pretty cool.
And I see a lot of parallels between what is happening in the microgrid area with technology as well. And Mark mentioned the leapfrogging of technology. Everybody has a smartphone today. In Indonesia, for example, there are no landlines, right, in the villages, etc. But you can see cell phone towers everywhere in the country. And that, that country has really leapfrogged communications from basically the 19th century to the 21st century without going in between and having sort of like a communications grid. You don't have to have a power grid anymore that goes across a large country like Indonesia or China or India, but just leapfrog that and go to the last mile by using technologies like microgrid.
Yeah, I think though, sometimes when we talk about microgrids and distributed generation. We make it sound as if this is all very easy to deliver. And it isn't, because the amount of investment you need if you go entirely down that track is
massive.
Is huge. And it isn't the optimum. I mean, the reality is you want to combine, you know, a reasonable operating centralized grid with these distributed resources. And most countries haven't yet really got their head around what it takes to do that. So actually investment in sort of grid infrastructure in many countries is tremendously lacking. And we have a very inefficient grid. In a lot of the developed world, again, you know, proper investment in the grid would bring huge efficiency benefits improvements. In China, they've been investing in massive high-voltage distribution systems, which are connecting their renewable resources with their population centers. But most other countries are not investing at that rate in the grid. So there is to get to a some of these things to work, you know, the cumulative investment over the coming decades is in the tens of trillions of dollars.
And
you know, in a way, I don't think everybody has fully recognized how much investment is needed in the sector. It has to scale up significantly from where it is today.
Do we have... That's right.
Hello, good morning. Miles McCarthy from Carbon Trust. I've got a question. We learned that Singapore government are currently consulting on a carbon tax, 10 to 20 Singapore dollars, I understand, for here in Singapore. What's the panel's views on the impactfulness of carbon taxes, whether it be mandatory or voluntary, around the world? How well are they going to support deployment of more renewables as well as energy efficiency? And maybe any thoughts on a price today and in the future that would have a material impact on accelerating the deployment of these new clean technologies?
Alvin, this is for you.
Start with the record.
You got to scan this question, though.
Sure. Well, I think there was just a recent announcement that the price points that we're looking at is about between $10 to $20. And one of the things that we are quite carefully balancing is you want to incentivize the right behavior by putting on a carbon tax in terms of how do you deploy more energy efficient technologies. Yet at the same time, the challenge is you don't want to increase the compliance cost for businesses. I think that is the tricky part. And some of this we're hoping that through the consultation process will come up.
Okay, that's good.
Yeah, you know, clearly, you know, from a Shell perspective, we've always said that putting a price on carbon in the end is going to be essential if you want to deliver on on the sort of CO2 objectives. And if you want to, if your vision is that the world needs to be net zero carbon emissions by 2050, I don't think any of us in Shell can see how you can do that without a price on carbon. Tricky bit is how do you put a price on carbon in a way that, as Alvin says, incentivizes the right behaviors. And doesn't put parts of your industry at a huge competitive disadvantage. So trying to get all of the different parties to act in unison on this is kind of a tough challenge. But it has to happen. And you know, certainly from as far as I can see, if you believe carbon capture and storage has to happen, I can't see how we can do that without a substantial price on carbon. And all of the work that's been done on by the IPCC on pathways to less than 2 degrees global warming say you must have carbon capture and storage, otherwise you never meet that objective.
Makes sense. Maybe a last question over there. Is there a question over there?
Yes,
oh yeah, the lady over there. Can we bring the microphone? All right, there you go.
I was just forgotten over here. Hi, my name is Leanne Graves. I'm the energy correspondent based in the UAE. My question is for Mark. How much
Who's Mark?
Does
because there are two Mark here. There's Mark
not you. I'm sorry.
Mark, we're not going to jump on it. You know, it's like.
How much does the New Energies division comprise of Shell's total expenditures, and also what's the outlook for this division over the next 5 to 10 years? Monetary percentages are most appreciated.
Yeah, so I can't give you a precise number. I can tell you there'll be tremendous growth in the new energy business over the next 5 years if I have anything to do with it, which I do. So we are going to grow, and you will have probably seen reported in the media recently that our CEO Ben Van Beurden was talking about this, and he said that his expectation is that we'll be spending towards $1 billion on new energies by 2020 per annum. So clearly, we know we need to get the business to a material scale, but it'll take time for us to do that. Because I've started with a small team. I'm building the team, building capability. We're looking at a range of different opportunities in biofuels, in hydrogen, in wind, in solar, digital ventures. I have a group looking at sort of new digital business models that can improve efficiency, connected customers. So we've got a very wide range of activities we're looking at. And when the time is right, we will spend, you know, material money on in those areas. But we've deliberately not set ourselves very specific short-term targets because the mission that I have is to explore, a bit like Star Trek, you know, explore boldly, new frontiers, all of that stuff, and work out where we can add the most value, because I don't want to take Shell into areas where other people are going to do it better than we would. I have to find a way that I can create value for customers and for shareholders in the process.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm going to take the honor and privilege of asking the very last question.
Okay.
Gentlemen on the stage, you have the power within you to create a movement for more and cleaner energy. What is that one thing that you would do in your role and capacity to bring that about? And in any shape and order, but I would like you to end it as the moderator. So I'll ask anybody to start, but I'll ask you to end it. What's the one thing? The power is in your hands. Yes, stump you.
I mean, you have 1 minute left. That's it. I mean, you should come up with something.
Something that you so do to start this movement for cleaner, more cleaner energy.
I'm always reluctant to try and boil it down to one thing.
Oh, I'm sorry.
On the grounds that, you know, our whole philosophy over the past 20 years has been to be very wary about the being ever claiming there's one silver bullet. You know, if you've got something which is a bigger challenge as providing the world with the energy it needs at a much lower environmental impact, you kind of need to deploy everything you got in the kit bag. You know, you need more renewables in the mix. You've got to have, you know, higher penetration of gas substituting coal. You need biofuels in transportation. You need to look at alternatives like electric vehicles, but also hydrogen. So for me, the one thing probably is getting people to understand that there is no silver bullet. And that we need everything that's available to us. You know, we need CCS as well. There has to be a real understanding, you know, a bit the challenge we've had with governments is they like it simpler to say there's one big thing.
I know.
At the moment, the one big massive type thing is battery electric vehicles in mobility. You can't do it. If people rely on waiting for battery electric vehicles as the one solution, we'll be waiting for too long. You know, we've got to make internal combustion engines more efficient. We've got to look at new mobility models that reduce the amount of traveling that's done. We've got to find a way to bring hydrogen into the mix. You got a ton of different things. So my one thing is to make people understand there is no one thing.
That's great stuff.
I like that. That movement for people to understand it. Thank you. Anybody else?
Maybe I'll just continue from what Mark just shared, because in Singapore right now, there is a lot of companies that are innovating, and there are a bunch of new technologies from sensors, your analytics, to your IoT, and down to all the different microgrid solutions. And one hope that I personally have is some of these capabilities that we've built up and the solutions that are developed out of Singapore can actually help to serve the broader Asia region.
My one thing is the together. I think we cannot just do it by ourselves. So the provider, the consumer, the government has to come together. I look at the oil and gas crisis and the price of the barrel came down. And one of the things that really was an eye-opener for the industry is you have to work together to bring the cost down, to bring the technology, to work on the adoption. So the movement would be, hey, you're not going to do it alone. We have to partner. I love the panel. It's just actually I work in the industry, but I see how it's coming together. It's really heartwarming somehow.
Well, much of the things that we want to do in terms of product, we're already doing. The one thing that we really need to figure out what to do is in terms of 3D printing in the future. It's not going to happen in the next 5 or 10 years, but it certainly will happen in 20-30 years time. And my dream as a consumer is this, right? I just came back from Jakarta last night. I took an Uber back to my house and I drove here this morning. I'd like to be able to fly on a much more environmentally friendly plane, buy my carbon credits before I fly, and take my driverless vehicle from the airport back to my house. And the same thing again, you know, this morning when I come and attend this conference. And that, I think, is the dream that we can all strive for.
Thank you. I think that's a great conclusion. I mean, maybe
in terms of conclusions, I mean, I'm not going to give you my bullet, but I think education, helping people, and I think the new generation understands what's at stake here. And I mean, probably here, I mean, the people are, probably Mark and I, we're probably the older here. We rely on them. I mean, it's just like the millennium generation. I mean, those people, they want to change the world. They want to change. I mean, and especially in the context that we're living here, you know, with a lot of populism and stuff like that, people are rising, okay, and they want to change, okay? And I think that the educations will help convince, basically, to pull people together to do something that's going to be really amazing. So I have have good feeling about that. And I think you can see that, basically, I mean, we assembled a panel here where people have been working very well together. So I think there's no reason why, I mean, we couldn't do that more. Okay, so thanks again to all our panelists. I think they did a great job.
And thank you very much. And so the partnership will start right here in being doing it together. At this point, I would like to invite Mr. Doug McKay, VP Government Relations Asia Pacific, Royal Dutch Shell, to join me here on stage to present a token of appreciation to our panelists. Doug. Right. Thank you, Mark.
Thank you so much. Yeah, my pleasure. Oops. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Doug.
Hi, Doug.
Good to see you.
Thank you.
Right. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in thanking them, and the photographer will take a good shot of them.